this topic is something I was hoping to do kind of as more of an interactive discussion as well. So, but this room is very long. So if anyone wants to kind of just move forward a little bit, that would be good. Otherwise, we'll just make do with what we got. So this is a Freelancer's Guide to Handling Difficult Clients. I'm Damon Schopen. I've been a web developer for 11 years now. I started Portlight Technology 4 years ago. I came from, you know, the corporate environment over to starting a business. And we develop custom web apps and do integrations. And as you can see, I'm from Wisconsin. So often when you're freelancing, you get a phone call from a potential customer. And it's really exciting. You get on the phone with them. You talk to them for, I don't know, maybe an hour or so, planning everything out. You quickly go ahead and agree on the deal. You agree on the project. And then after you kind of hang up the phone, you kind of have like this feeling in your stomach like, something doesn't feel quite right with this project. But you get going. You get coding or building or designing or whatever you do. And just start working on the project because you're super excited to be having a new client, a new project. The money is coming in. Life is good. And then a few days go by and you notice there's like more and more requests from the customer that keep piling in and coming in and showing up. And then one Friday afternoon, you get a phone call from a customer and they're like, yeah, we're going to launch it on Monday, or we're going to finish it on Monday, right? We're ready to go. We've got this big event we're doing, or a product launch, or whatever the case may be. And at that point, you get this sinking feeling in your stomach, and you're going, there is no way we'll finish this project by Monday. And you're like, all right, I got to work all weekend, but it's probably still not going to get done. And meanwhile, the client is excited, because they don't, you know, grasp yet that it's not possible to be done. They think the project is easy, right? Because everybody's got a website, or everybody's got a logo, or
it's just HTML.
Yeah, exactly. You know, right? It's just HTML. It's super easy. But you know, after the weekend is over, you come to just dread the day you met that client. And you feel terrible about the project, and you really, you know, wanted to do your best, but of course you didn't meet the deadline. The client's frustrated, you're frustrated. When the phone rings and it's them, you don't even want to pick it up. You dread every email that comes in, and everybody has a bad experience. So most freelancers, you know, they're great with their craft and what they do. You know, I certainly was when I left the corporate world. But don't have the experience with the business side of things, which can be just as important or even more important in a lot of cases. So as I said, I wanted to kind of make this an open discussion here, because I think this group as a whole probably has a lot to offer each other as well. So I just kind of wanted to get a sense, first of all, who's out in the audience. How many of you are freelancers currently? You want to raise your hand? About half the room. And how many of you have been doing it for more than 2 years? More than 5 years? All right, cool. We've got some experts in the audience here today. And how many of you want to get into freelancing or starting a business? Got a few. That's great. Any other reasons you're here that I haven't covered? All right. Great. So as we kind of talk through some of these topics, feel free to just shout out and I'll try to repeat it back for the camera and or raise your hand. But I think there's a wealth of knowledge here that we can all share with each other. So, you know, compared to the scenario I just portrayed, where you just kind of rush into the project and get going, I know I did that a lot, especially when I first started out. Some of you can probably relate to that as well. But one thing that's key is to interview the client. You know, you always think of you're interviewing for a job or the customer's interviewing you, but you should also interview the client as well. and have a clear process for that. When you interview a client, one of the processes I have, and maybe some of the people will want to share theirs, would be, when I get a prospective client that reaches out to me or a referral or an email, you know, I jump on it and get back to them right away. But what I do is I schedule just a quick 15, 20 minute phone call first, even if they're like right down the street, because that saves your time and their time to just make sure that, you know, what they're looking for is what you can provide, and what you want to do will serve them well. And within that short 15, 20 minute conversation, you can at least kind of get a baseline, you know, and go, for me, for example, we build software. So if someone's saying, well, I want like a brochure style website, I would say, you know, that's not really in our wheelhouse, but I've got these great other people that I can refer to you, you know, and that's kind of turns you almost into a kind of point of contact that someone can go to anytime and be, you know, hey, do you know someone who can do this? Do you know someone who can do that? And you're always kind of on their mind. So when the right project comes, you're the natural thought there. And then what I do is have subsequent meetings with them, even before getting a proposal. One, to build trust. Two, to, you know, get deeper into it to really make sure that this project is going to be something that we're a good fit for, and that the client has the right budget for the project as well and the right expectations. You know, very often you have clients who might come to you that just want a price instantly, you know, and I'm not able to give you a price instantly. I can probably give you a price range, you know, just to make sure we're kind of in the same ballpark, but it's like building a house, right? Do you want a three-bedroom house? Do you want a two-bedroom house? Do you want high-end appliances? Do you want stuff from IKEA? You know, I mean, whatever you need is great, but that can vary pricing quite a bit. So people who are generally looking for a price are just kind of tire kickers, in my experience, trying to get, you know, either a quick price to go against someone else, you know, and be like, hey, they said they could do it for half of what you can do, kind of a thing. But yeah, I don't know. Does anyone else have any experiences they'd want to share with that? Yeah.
I would say when someone calls and wants a price right away, I just inflate it by two or three times. And you would be surprised the number of people that say, that sounds great.
Oh, there you go.
So, I mean, seriously. Yep, seriously.
Wow. Just raise the price. Yeah, there you go.
And oftentimes I do that because I see them as one of those problem clients down the line.
Yeah.
And, you know, those will self-select out because they know that, hey, the other guy can do it for, X minus Y.
Right, right.
I kind of do the same thing because I do websites. I would work for bands.
Okay.
I also book bands, and people call up, what's your price?
Yep.
And depending on the situation, they want a price right then, and it's like, well, it depends. I mean, the band's in Florida, and you're in Washington. You know, it's going to cost travel and all that stuff, just like you.
Yeah.
I'm going to go as high as I think that market will have and see what happens. Because a lot of people are like, you will come from Florida, Washington for $500? No, I can't even drive out of out of the thing for that.
Right.
So, yeah, inflate the price and just see what happens. Because you can always back up. You can always come back down and go, well, hey, we just happen to be in Washington. We can give you a great deal. You know,
yep.
That kind of thing. So.
Absolutely.
Don't go crazy, you know.
Oh, yeah. And that's kind of why I like to give a range as well, because, you know, you can be like, well, you know, on the high side, we could be here, but, you know, we could also be more on this low side. We'll probably land in the middle, but, you know, let's figure that out so you have a solid price to move forward with. But, yeah. So once you do that initial interaction, interview, and figure out that they're a good fit, it's not just quick off to the races. You know, you want to plan out and make sure that you clearly scope and figure out what the project all is going to involve. You know, if it's a website, you know, roughly at least how many pages, you know, is this going to be like a quick 5-page thing, or do they have like an entire product catalog of 1,000 products that need to go on this website? Just to kind of get yourself narrowed down. And having the time, you know, like I think like Rachel was talking about in the prior talk, having those conversations are really important so that you can drill down and dig into what their true need is and what they're really looking for. hey, I need a website. Well, everybody needs a website, but what do you really want to do with it? You know, are you looking to get leads? Are you looking to sell products? You know, what is the purpose of the website? You want to make sure that you have a contract. How many of you have a contract that you use with your clients? All right, that's pretty good. Not as many hands as there were freelancers, though. So definitely do invest in that contract. You know, it is a little bit of an investment, but it's worth it because, you know, and it's not just for the point of, you know, say things go horribly wrong and you have to go to court. I mean, that's worst case scenario. You know, the contract can outline, you know, a lot of your key processes. You know, what is the payment schedule going to be? What are deliverables going to be? You know, what's included in this project? So it's clear on both sides, you know. Are you just building a logo or are you building an entire website, you know? Or did they think the logo was just going to be included? So make sure you have a contract and get that signed before you start. A lot of this, too, is education. I find, especially in the software and web world, you know, most customers that I work with, they're not that tech savvy, right? I mean, and nor do they need to be, right? That's why they're coming to us as a freelancer to do this work. So a lot of it is educating, you know. Customer says, I want 50 main menu items on the top of their site, right? You would probably say, well, you could do that, but here's some good reasons why. People aren't going to find what they're looking for, you know. So you are an authority and an expert, and those valuable insights that you offer are valuable, and it's going to be helping them to be successful. Having a solid process as well. How many of you have a process for bringing on clients and doing the work? A few. Okay, that's good. I will admit, you know, like I said, I've been doing this for 4 years as a freelancer. My processes are probably not quite narrowed down as good as I'd like them to be, but I'm continuing to refine them, and you can grow with that, you know. But I do, for a number of things that I do repeatedly, at least have checklists, you know. So, okay, new clients coming on. One, send out the contract. Two, send out the invoice. Three, set up the Dropbox or whatever, you know, so that the client can put all the deliverables in there. And it's amazing how fast you can go through that stuff when you've just got this checklist that you can go down every single time you know, just execute, you know. And you won't forget a step. You'll stay very consistent. Customers will know what to expect. And you want to go through that process with your customers at the beginning. Oops. Uh-oh. so that they're clear, you know, how do you develop or what is your process from start to finish for the entire project so that they know, okay, I'm going to see some rough drafts after week two, and then I'll have a week to respond to those or whatever makes sense for your business, right? But then it's clear, you know, especially when you're working on larger projects, you just might have a lot to do, right, in the beginning after you gather those requirements before you have something to show them, and they might start going, hello, what's going on? But if you're clear, you know, okay, this is going to take me a week or two to put the first revisions together, you know, then they know what to expect and when. Anyone else have thoughts on process or what works well for them and their processes? All right. Another important part is get the down payment. You know, don't be afraid to ask for money. I think a lot of times when you're starting out, having conversations about money can feel really awkward because you came from maybe a job at a company where you discussing salary was even kind of awkward always because you didn't talk about it much. No one talked about what each other made. But be confident in your rates and definitely get the down payment though, because, or how many of you do get a down payment? I guess I should ask that. That's good. That's a bigger group, yeah. Because, you know, you're investing your time and setting it aside, so you want to make sure that you're going to be compensated for it. And then have clear milestones, right, when those additional payments are due, so that you continue moving forward. I mean, they expect you to deliver on the project, so it's only fair that they should be delivering with the payment as well. And this is definitely one I've learned the hard way myself. So I've had clients where, you know, we had the milestone set where the next payment was due, and, you know, being the nice guy, I felt sorry for it. I'm like, okay, you know, and believe them. Okay, yeah, sure, no problem. We can delay the payment as long as we do it by this date, you know, and I deliver and then wait a year for the payment, right? So that's not a fun experience for anybody. So definitely have the confidence to stop the work if you need to stop the work to receive the payment that you deserve. And then value yourself. I think that's another thing that a lot of freelancers don't always do a good job at. You know, your time and your expertise and your experience is worth probably a lot more than you're thinking, you know? If you're getting every job and every gig, you know, you probably are not charging, well, you're definitely not charging enough, right? Because you should have a healthy number of people go, no, you know, I can't afford this project, but I would love to do it, you know, maybe in the future or something like that. Some people should be saying no, right? Because you can go to GoDaddy, right, and create a website on their website builder, or go to Squarespace and create a Squarespace site, but really, you know, what you're providing is that knowledge and expertise of how to do it properly. And that is valuable. Be sure, yeah.
I've had the experience where I quoted on building a WordPress website, and the people didn't like what I quoted, so then they go, oh, well, I can go to Wix or Squarespace and build myself a website. So they go ahead and go there.
Mm-hmm.
Then they come back to me and say, we can't figure this out. Can you go in our Wix website and make it look okay? And then that's double the price that I would have originally charged per hour, because it's like, you wouldn't go with me in the first time, and now you want me to go work in something that, you know, is not easy to work in.
Right, right. And it may not even be possible to do some of the things you need to do, because those tools are basic, you know? And they may be fine depending on your need, right? But yeah, I've had that experience as well. I quoted out a large project for a client, and they went with another provider, and I was like, sure, no problem, no big deal. I was, thanks for your opportunity to quote it. It was fun. And a year later, they came back to me. They still hadn't launched or gotten the project off the ground, and we came in, recovered the project. And so they paid me about what I had quoted originally, plus they paid the other provider all of the work that they did. So it was double, to your point, you know. But yeah, you know, but definitely stick to your value. You know, I've also had a lot of times people will say, well, but my budget's only this. You know, they'll say it's like 30% less of what you gave the proposal for. And can't you just meet that price? And no, you don't want to do that, because now people are dictating to you your worth, you know. Oh, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. How can we modify the scope of this project to fit within your budget? You know, you can usually find common ground. In your experience, you know, you can usually find common ground with that, right? You know, by removing maybe service X or, yeah, you know, they'll get a different solution, but, you know.
It's possible, but if not, then just, you know, say that.
But yeah, you do have to stick to your guns, that's for sure, especially when you're starting out. It could, you know, you just want the job so bad, right? Because you want to get established and get started, yeah.
The other thing, too, is if you do drop your price to 30%, well, then they go to their friends who want a website,
mm-hmm.
and go, well, they built my, you know, and they come to you and you give a price and they go, well, you built my friend's website for 30% less.
Right, exactly.
And then you're stuck, you know, because.
You
so
are.
That's my, I just raised my price, and the people, I haven't gotten as much work.
Mm-hmm.
I made up for that because I'm only working for two people for what I was getting probably paid for 3 to 5 people. So, and I only got two people yelling at me instead of five people.
You're so, probably spending less time too, right?
Less time, and I've learned over my 20 years of experience of, to learn to like vet people, like you were saying, you know, your working relationship and such. And one of my tricks is I have a like she would say, people call up, what's your price, or they want me to do the same price that I've been working with this client for umpteen years, and their price is here. My price is here now. No, if you wanted it, that kind of thing. But I also have time wasters that call me like every couple months going, thinking I'm going to lower their price because I'm coming back. I start marking down on a sheet how much time I've talked to them. So the first time, if they do lock in, and they get a little bit, they don't like to talk to me several times.
Mm-hmm.
But the first time they lock into paying me, they get billed for that time.
Sure, sure.
You know, if they've wasted an hour of my time, I'm adding an hour to my bill. Because that's just not,
Yeah.
I just try to get that in there.
Absolutely. I mean, at the end of the day, when you're a freelancer, it's your time is how you make money, right? And there's only so many hours in the day, so you do have to be very protective of your time and your schedule and try to be as efficient as possible. And yeah, if there are those time wasters, you obviously want to be polite and respectful to them, and yeah, tracking your time that you spend with them is a great way to do that. I've done that as well, where I track all of my time. How many of you track your time? That's another good... Okay, so yeah, a lot of people do that. That's good. It's great to look back on that and go, wow, I spent a lot of time on that project, or actually that went better than I thought, and you make a little more money, or you could split the difference with the client if you want to, but it doesn't hurt to make a little... I mean, you're providing the value, really, at the end of the day, so it's not usually just time for money, right, as well. You provide this logo that goes on for the next 20 years to be the representation of that brand, it's probably worth more than $50, So definitely, yeah, value your time. Another thing, too, is the promise of future work. I've had that come up a few times where people will say, well, if you could just do this for free for me here quick, or do it less, I'm going to redo the whole website in another couple of months, I promise, and I'll use you, that's a trap I think people fall into, and if they really value you and your skills and experience, you got to do that work, all of it, for what it's worth, not just stuff later. And don't be afraid to say no. Oops. No. Oh, it's fine. Okay. Don't be afraid to say no. If a client is not a right fit, it's okay. Let them move on. It's better to figure that out early than later. But at any point in the process, if you figure out, this is just not working, have that conversation with the client and move on. I think everyone will be happier for it. Early on when I started, I had a potential client, and this is probably where I did everything wrong. but it was a great learning experience, we spent a lot of time up front talking and planning, and they were asking me a lot of questions, and I was sharing a lot of knowledge that really probably should have been consulting time, looking back at it now, only to find out, we finally got to the point of getting started on the work, and I said, okay, let's do the down payment here. And it was a really small project even. And they said, well, the changes that that you're going to be making are needed so that we can do our big event and make the money. And I'm like, well, no. At that point, I was like, all right, sorry, I can't do this. You've got to make the down payment before I do the work. But I invested way too much time in that early on. So. Don't be afraid to say no. It wasn't fun, but you gotta protect yourself to begin with. I think those were kind of the main points I had. I think happy clients. Oops, not moving forward. What's going on? There we go. Happy clients are good clients, and they give you energy and excitement, and also referrals, which are great. I've gotten a lot of really quality clients from referrals. So thank you. Questions? Yeah.
You know,
Yes.
So I, you know, I've been burned many times.
Sure.
Because I thought that I set expectations, and I thought that I hit all the contingencies and the whens and the wheres and the exactly whats, but then they didn't have the same expectations that I did. So I feel like I wish there was a big checklist in the sky.
Yeah.
Expectations that I could check off. Okay, we covered the whens, we covered the hows, we covered the... But, you know, no matter
yeah, yeah, that's a good point. Sure. Yeah, that is a good point. And setting expectations is hard, you know, especially when everyone is in a different mindset, frame of mind, technical level, experience level. But setting expectations is really important. I think some of the ways I set expectations is, you know, having just deep, deep conversations, one. Clearly defining what's going to be involved in the work. I actually probably go a little on the overboard side of that sometimes, but I think that time invested is worth it. You know, we develop custom software, so if we were doing a small website, I may not take it quite so far, but with the software we develop, we do an entire like requirements document. You know, we'll do mock-ups, we'll do this is how the user interacts with this screen. This is the outcome they want to experience. This is input. You know, we really get it nailed down. And we do often charge for that. But at that point, they have a plan that they can take with them to any other development company or any other developer. And at that point, it's mainly just execution. You know, a lot of those requirements and planning is gathered. But yeah, expectations can be hard. Anyone else have any ways that they better set expectations? Yeah, go ahead.
So I work for a company that has software that we provide as a service, okay. But we also have a process where our clients can come and request features, and when we create a contract, we make sure to include all of the different things that will be included with what we're providing. And a lot of times, depending on client needs or wants or desires, they think that there's something included in that contract that isn't. So what we do at that point is just get into a discussion on why that isn't included and how much more it would cost to implement that. And a lot of times at that point, the answer on their side will be no, well, like, I thought this was included, but I don't want that. But it really helps to just go through and detail exactly why or why not, like, something isn't included in that contract that you, like, the biggest thing that we do, I think, is educate and give information. And once people have the information, even if they're not happy with it, they end up happier as a whole.
Absolutely, yeah, you know, and I do a very similar thing where, yeah, if that comes up, you know, it's like, oh, I thought X was included, you know, we sit down. I mean, a lot of it is just pure communication, right? And communication is hard. It doesn't seem like it should be, but it is hard, right? And picking up the phone or sitting down in person is a very key, you know, to making that communication happen. But yeah, I as well, you know, when I get a question about, oh, I thought this would be included, you know, we sit down and review and talk about why it's not. You know, I think I use the analogy a lot of if you're building a house and you want a 3-bedroom house with average appliances, you know, middle of the range, you know, that's great. If you went back to the builder then and said, oh, I want a home theater in the basement, right? That's going to be obviously more of a cost. And I think that non-technical description kind of helps people think that through, but yeah, that can be hard. But yeah, good point.
Well, it's also one phrase to keep in your head, especially if you're starting as a freelancer or anything, is the phrase scope creep.
Yeah.
Scope creep. That is like your biggest thing. And I have to use the analogy, especially since I do my contracts for bands. You read some of my writers, you know, and this is the thing, everybody laughs about you know, was that Van Halen said they own no green M&Ms. That was a test, because a lot of people don't read the contract. And if I got backstage and there were green M&Ms, I know they didn't read the contract. And it comes down to towels. I want black towels. I get backstage, there's white towels. I know they didn't read it. But the people that do read it, they'll call me and they'll say, do you really need black towels? I'll go, no, we don't. I said, any towels are fine. I'm just happy to get towels. But also being clear on the contract of what will be provided, because if you read the one writer for one client, if you wrote on the contract, you said airport transportation, what would that mean to you? Pick your client up at the airport, bring him to the hotel, bring him to the venue, you know, reverse. I had a client that only thought it had to do it one way. Just left us at the venue. How do we get back to our hotel? Not even. And then another one, I'll even say a local venue to here, a huge festival on the waterfront, said, we got done on one of the main stages and said, oh, well, I said, how do we get our equipment back to the van that's a mile away in the parking lot? And they said, oh, we can just walk. He was like, no, not gonna happen. So now our contract says, transportation from the airport to the hotel and back and return, you know, I have to spell it out. You have to spell it out, because some people just do not or will take advantage of that. You didn't say I had to bring it back.
Yeah, I think, you know, for me too, as once I'm finally to the point of a final agreement here, by this point, we have talked through this project so many times, it feels like I'm a broken record just repeating myself. And I know when I'm talking with customers, they're like, yep, that's it. Yeah, you know, like we all got it now, you know, because we've probably talked through each piece 3 or 4 times. And it's really clear, you know. Sometimes I'll put together a PowerPoint that goes through it all, and we go through that. I always put together like a written document that we go through to go through that. But yeah, does that help at all with expectations?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, sure.
Yeah.
So as kind of a new freelancer, I've always done a lot of my work for other businesses. One of the things that I'm finding and learning from my mistakes is that getting content from certain clients is hell, to be honest.
Yeah.
Right now I've got a project that's been going on about 6 months, but it's a contract where it's not one of my freelance clients, it's through a contractor, so I am kind of stuck with it, which is how I'm learning. But what would you, I'm putting in my new contracts that there's gonna be a deadline to get me content, or I'm canceling your project and keeping the deposit for the work I've done.
Yep.
Because there's no point in me continuing to turn down other clients at that point. But what is a reasonable expectation for that time frame to get content? How long should you wait once you're stopped and can't do anymore before you say, forget it, I'm done?
Sure. You know what, I've probably never said completely like, forget it, I'm done. But what I do, and maybe others do something different here, is maybe that content finally does show up. It's not a stop everything and put that content in, right? It's a, okay, you know, at this point I've been filling in my schedule with other projects and keeping my work moving forward, so I'm happy to work it in, but it's not gonna be until whatever, you know, I mean, when you have the next availability. I mean, you don't wanna blow them off or push them off for, you didn't get it to me for 6 months, so I'm not going to do it for you for 6 months, you know, but I would do it at your, when you can reasonably do it, you know, and I would, you know, say to them up front too early on, you know, if content doesn't come back, we will have to shuffle around the schedule and we'll get you in when we can. And then when the delays start happening, make that clear too, you know, and pick up the phone and make a call and send an email, right? Because, oh, okay.
That's the joke.
Yeah.
We never provide anything.
Sure.
And yet they want to have weekly progress meetings, which I'm charging them for.
Okay, as long as you're charging for it, that's great. Otherwise, I would bow out of those meetings until, you know, they're ready to have productive conversation again, right? You know, but yeah. But yeah, I mean, I don't know, I guess use your best judgment as far as deciding, you know, this is not working. I mean, with the client that, like I was talking about earlier, I just knew in my gut that, okay, it's just time to call it quits, right? And if you feel like it's time to call it quits and you're not sure, it probably is. right? You know, your gut's usually probably a lot better than you think. And yeah, anyone else have thoughts on that? Any other questions? Yeah. I do a little bit for free in the beginning,
like the
but
first one, because I've run into where I've had a meeting with some mm-hmm. potential client, and we talk for a couple hours about their website and everything, and I give them a couple ideas, mm-hmm. and then they go with someone else with
yeah.
ideas.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's I just wasted 2 hours of my time or more.
Yeah.
Know? So that's why I was asking if you charge for that.
That's tricky, you know. I usually give a couple hours for free, or at least an hour for free. Depending, it depends, I think, on how well I know this client.
Right.
Because I want to build trust, and I want to build, because there's so much bad reputation out there with freelancers as well, you know. I mean, I'm sure you've all talked to people who've had horror stories with a freelancer or someone, you know. I mean, especially in the website world, like, I almost feel like every week I hear someone's like, oh, my developer or designer or whoever was terrible, and they probably weren't. It was probably more of an expectations and communication problem, but yeah, so I like to build that trust, so I usually give a little time in the beginning, but I just have to be sure not to be giving away too much, right?
Right.
And recurring customers, I really don't. Then it's pretty much all billable, you know, or included, because we have that trust at that point. Yeah. Anyone else have thoughts on that? Yeah.
On another topic, how do you keep the client happy? How do you sell your services to them?
Sure, sure. So keeping them happy, I think, you know, clear communication, delivering what they're looking for, and I mean, there's many ways, really. But I think clear communication is a big part of it. You know, as long as they're knowing what to expect and they're liking the outcome that you're providing, they're generally happy. I mean, I don't think it's too hard to keep people happy, you know. I think picking up the phone and just talking to them is, you know, a lot of people love email and email's great, but, or if they're nearby, get together in person, you know, because that just, you know how it is. I mean, it's much easier to build a trust and rapport and communication with someone in person or on the phone than, yeah.
I think creative billing is a great way just to judge what kind of client you have. And this client kind of wants invoicing done this way and this client, so I don't have a one rule fits all. But one of the things that I probably shouldn't do, but I do, I work for an agency, and the way I handle the few clients that I have, I do, what I find a lot of them don't like is this attorney kind of billing system where every time you touch base with them, they're thinking they're going to get charged. So the kind of thing where the way I handle them is like, I'll do all your text updates, I'll do all your link changes, I'll do all your image changes, and then when something major comes along, I remind them, but remember all that other stuff I did? I didn't charge you for that, but I'm going to charge you for this, and this is the real price for that. So that's just one of my personal things. My boss kind of doesn't know I do it that way, but it's...
Well, now you're coming.
The rapport that I've now got with the ones that I deal with and their best friend, like, that night when they just need help to do something really quick, I'll do that, and I won't nail them for that. And then when something big comes along, they trust that I'm making, well, actually, Amy, that's a lot bigger than all those other changes that you made, and this is why, and this is how I'm going to do it. But that works with one. They tease me in the office because I have English charm. I'm just arrogant or whatever, and I just say it. But that's what I've found works for me. It's just get a little bit creative and know when to charge them and when not to charge them, type thing.
That's a good point. Yeah, that hourly billing can feel like the meter's always running for every phone call.
And they don't call then, and then phone me. The moment you get frustrated, mm-hmm. phone me, because I don't want you getting negative on this this situation. I'll do it if it's going to keep the peace, you know, and then you'll have certain ones that that'll keep doing that, but then that's Mary Beth's job here is like, we can see that this client is always calling us, are they a good client or not? We rate those clients, we have a rating system, one through five. And if it's a one client, we deal with them straight away. If it's a five client, you've gone on the back burner. So it's, we're an agency, so we're slightly different than freelancing, but we can pick and choose that. So definitely, internally, you could do that also. Just rate your clients and then handle your customer care on that rating and don't break that rule ever.
Yeah, and I think it's little things too, like send them a thank you card when you complete a project. You know, if they're struggling with something and it'll take you 10 minutes, help them, right? You know, provide them with more value than they feel like they're paying you, you know? And a lot of those little things I think can really kind of put it over the edge. One of the clients of mine who does a significant amount of business with me every month, had a hard drive die, and they just shipped to me to see if I could recover the data. I don't know much about it, but I used to do that. I'm not charging them for it because I don't know if I could even do it or not, but I'll spend an hour or two on it, right? But they'll be so thrilled if I get that data off, you know? So, yeah, you know, I think it's the level of the client there that comes into that as well, but, you know, the little things that you can do to just help them. If they got a quick question, answer it, you know?
Don't get desperate. I think that's when you start getting desperate. That's when you start making silly, rash decisions on this whole thing. It's just like,
for sure.
Yeah.
I was just going to add on the question regarding like that initial meeting.
Mm-hmm.
I think of that meeting as a marketing meeting. You're going in, you're selling your services, you're selling what you can do for them. But it's not a design meeting. It's not a, like, if they want like in-depth consultation, if they want you to start laying out things, you know, give them a little bit to tease them maybe.
Yeah.
Like, hey, here's like what I've done, or oh, you know, I've got some really great ideas. But don't, you know, don't give away the milk for free. Make them buy the cow.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. No, that's definitely a good point. You know, yeah, you want to maybe show them that you can, you're up to the task, right? But yeah, you don't want to give it away.
It helps if you set a time limit on that first meeting too. And, you know, as far as like, hey, I've got booked from, you know, I can fit you in from 2 to 3, and give that expectation that you're not going to be sitting there with them all afternoon.
Yeah.
So you have an easy out. I mean, if you want to keep going, great.
Yeah.
Like, you know, if they're putting money on the table, great. Sit down and keep going. But if it's like, you know, they're trying to push you for more, oh, it's out of time. Give me a call. Let's.
Yeah.
You can always say, sorry, it's time for my next appointment or my next call, you know, I mean, they don't know, right?
And you can even offer, like, if they are, you know, wanted a design, like, but maybe not development, like, you can talk about that. You can talk about selling design. You can price it out accordingly. It's a nice thing about, you know, when you do work for yourself is you can set it up whatever makes sense.
It is, yeah, very good point. Any other questions, thoughts? The number one thing that's gotten you through the last 5 years or 20 years. all right. Well, thank you so much. And I will be at the Happiness Bar if anyone, right? That's what it's called? I think, yeah. Okay. All right. Thank you.